Hey everybody, it's Eric Sachs over at breakthroughbroker.com. I can't believe how many realtors we had signed up for this. At last check, we had 3,372 real estate professionals signed up for this call. And I think, and typically we get that for some of our technology focused classes, but this is interesting because this is real, right? We all know like 10 other realtors in our world, and our friends know 10 other real estate professionals. And so we've lost deals. We've had issues with this. So I'm so excited to see everyone on this call. If you're new to our webinars, it's live. Make it interactive, please. If you're having trouble with your audio, it's probably on your end. Right now I'm showing that my audio is looking great. So if you're having trouble with your audio, please check your internet connections. This is being recorded. You'll get a recording later today or tomorrow. So it is being recorded. Please ask questions. Please interject. If you guys have done things that I'm not talking about, share them with this group because it's all about growth and helping each other sell more homes. So we're going to get started. And, you know, how to be the one realtor your friends choose when you know 10 others. We're going to go over some interesting things today. A little of it is mindset. And I know that we're learning so much technology and there's so much out in the industry and we're taking so many classes. Today, we're gonna backtrack a little and do a little mindset. Quick shout out, it's funny, we do classes in front of thousands of people and we do these webinars every month. And then when one of your mentors in the speaking industry is on the call, it rattles you a little bit. So shout out to Sean Carpenter, who's one of the best speakers in the industry. I see him on this call. So. You made me nervous, buddy. So we're gonna get rock and roll, and we're gonna get going. So you know, everybody on this call has probably received this, right? And everybody on this call has received a message, a Facebook post, an event invite for a housewarming party for your clients, past clients, friends, or family, and you didn't sell the home, right? You're scrolling through Facebook, and you're like, housewarming party for the Johnsons? Wait a second. And then you have all those emotions, right? You feel nauseous. You feel sick to your stomach. How in the world did they not use me? Why did they not use me? And then you get angry, right? You start complaining. I can't believe they did that to me. I can't believe they used someone else to buy that house or to sell their house, or worse, to sell and buy a new house. And I'm assuming almost everyone on this call has had this happen to them. If it hasn't happened to you, trust me, it will. So the reason for this call is to have a discussion on how to not have this happen to you, how to be the one real estate agent that your friends and family and your sphere of influence chooses over all the other ones that they know. Guys, where I live and when I travel on the road, but where I live, you can't go into a Starbucks without literally running into 5 or 7 real estate agents. And when the market's good, more people get into the industry. So we're combating this. You know, and part of this class used to be, in the beginning, part of this class used to talk about, you know, the difference between buying leads. So you guys can go out there and you can purchase leads, right? For thousands of dollars, you can buy leads from Realtor.com and Zillow and Commissions Inc. and all of those different places out there to buy leads. And I'm not saying it's wrong, but some of the highest conversion rates to buy a lead for you guys to buy or sell a home with somebody, and you're using these tools that are giving you leads, some of the highest conversion rates are 4%. The highest conversion rates. Think about a referral or when a friend or family member says, man, you really should use Eric. What's your conversion rate on that? It should typically be almost 100%. So if we're balancing and we wanna grow a business, let's grow a business on referrals. Let's grow a business on leveraging the people we know in our world. So whose fault is it that you saw that, that you saw an invite to a housewarming party from someone who you were positive would use you for their next purchase of a home. Someone who you've talked to 4 or 5 months ago about buying an investment property posted about their fix and flip that they just sold. Whose fault is that? We tend to blame them. We tend to be upset with them and we talk bad about our friends who aren't using us, but it's really your fault, right? And guys, I'll get to some of these questions and answers. And somebody says it's really bad when your sister-in-law uses somebody else. Kayla, my uncle used somebody else. So it's just as bad, right? For me, some of you know that I came from law enforcement. So I was a police detective and police officer for 13 years before I got into real estate. And I was battling for 5, 6, 7 years after that. People were thinking, oh my gosh, sorry I didn't use you. I thought you were still a cop. But it was my fault. It was my fault for not making sure everybody knew. Okay, so it's not their job to remember. Okay, it's not the people you know's job to figure out how to refer you. It's not their job to think of you every time real estate is mentioned. But I want that for you. You want that for yourself. So the idea here is to make sure that we realize that being the one realtor our friends and family and sphere of influence chooses when they all know 10 others, it lies on us to do the work to make sure that we're hitting on all cylinders, that we are the ones they're thinking about when it comes time to refer. Now, most of you have great spheres of influence. Most of you are in a marketplace where you know a lot of people. When I was selling, I had been in Fort Collins, Colorado for 22 years. I went to college there. I was a police officer there. I worked in different segments of the law enforcement world. I was in the school district for a long time. So I knew a lot of people. My sphere of influence could have been somewhere close to 3,000 or 4,000 at one point. Okay, so how in the world do we make sure that they're using us, right? The unfortunate thing about your sphere of influence, and yes, even people who love you, even people who live right next door to you, and longtime friends and family and past clients, the unfortunate thing about all of this and what we do is that we look the same to them. To them, you look like every other realtor they know. You do the same job of every other realtor they know, okay? And so it's important to, I'm just looking at some of the questions, guys. I'm gonna get to some of these. And if you have audio problems, please check your internet connection. Our audio looks to be good right now on our end. So again, guys, we have to change the perception of everyone we know. We have to change the way they look at us individually, not as a group, because they already have a preconceived notion about a realtor. They have a preconceived notion about what you do and how you make money. And so it lies upon us to change that, okay? And so as we start this journey, I think it starts with mindset. Now, if anyone is on this call and they're from where I sold, I apologize. But when I left the police department, I had to hustle, right? I had to go out and get the business because I left a really good career that paid well, that I got a paycheck every 2 weeks, they paid for my health insurance, all that stuff. And then I went out into the world of commission only. And so my mindset over the years got very confident. And I drove down the street. I don't want you to think I'm cocky, but I drove down the street in Fort Collins, Colorado. And sorry for any of you guys on the call who I sold with, but I drove down the street thinking, when I saw a sign from another realtor, that person who owned that home was crazy for not using me. In my mind, I felt like I should have 100% penetration in my marketplace. I felt that every single person should choose me to sell or buy a home. I felt like I was a great negotiator and that I was really personable and that I was the best real estate agent in my market. That was my mindset. I wasn't the top of the highest producer. We didn't have the highest producing company. We didn't have the highest market share, but I felt that way. So it starts with your mindset, because the people who you are with at lunch, at a barbecue, at a coffee meeting, they see that in you. So how you feel about yourself as a realtor shows to the people who know you. It starts to show through over the course of time. And you want every single person you know to think to themselves, I'm freaking crazy if I don't refer Eric every time someone mentions the word house, because Eric makes me look good. And so it starts with mindset, you know, and Gina, I agree. Gina says she has 57,000 agents in her area of competition. So most of you do. Most of you do. We had somewhere around 1,500 agents, but we only had 120,000 people, 130,000 people. So we're all in a dogfight for the business. So it starts with mindset, guys. I want you to start thinking about this. If you take nothing else away from what we talk about today, if you get off this webinar, I want you to think to yourself, why would I hire me? And I want you to answer that. That answer should be part of your DNA. That answer should be better than the 10 other realtors that your friends know. That answer should be rattled off with confidence, and it should win every conversation. So I want you to think about this when you're off the webinar. I want you to think, why would I hire me for the largest financial transaction of my life? Why would I hire me to buy an investment property or to sell my house and buy another house? This is an important question. And the answer is something that we should practice. So here's a tough question, because we're on this call because we want to be better. We want to be better so we can get more referrals. We want to get more referrals so we can sell more homes and make more money for our family. It's all a chain reaction, right? So I have a tough question for you. Are you remarkable? Because remember, they see us the same as every other realtor they know. So how are you remarkable? Are your conversations that you're carrying on with the people that you know at coffee, lunch, or a weekend barbecue noteworthy? Will someone go back home and look at their husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend and say, wow, I had a great conversation with Eric tonight? That's where it begins. You have to be better. And I'm going to say this a few times. A lot of us get into this industry and hope. We work on the hope method of success. We sit back and we wait for business to fall in our lap. And we're not really constantly getting better. But I'm going to tell you guys this. In order to be the one realtor your friends choose when they know 10 others, you actually have to be better than the other 10. So what kind of conversations you have are what we're going to be talking about today. So for example, it's barbecue season, right? I spoke in Tucson a couple weeks ago. It was like 113 degrees. So I'm not sure they do barbecues like outside. But for those of you in normal climates, you're at barbecue season, right? We're talking to our neighbors. We're in the backyard and people love real estate, right? People absolutely love talking real estate. It's funny for me because I was in the two professions that people love talking about. They love cop stories and asking about real estate. So how's the market? How many times have you guys been asked this year? How's the market? You know, how is the market? How would you guys answer this? Guys, I have all kinds. Please answer this for me. Somebody tell me what you say. Type it in. How's the market? I'm seeing things like hot. Great. What else, guys? Come on. Unbelievable. Thanks, Jeremy. How's the market? You're having a beer over the barbecue. How's the market? Unbelievable. It's great. Seller's market. Fabulous. It's incredible. Guys, thank you. I'm seeing all this. That's great, right? The market's great. It's hot. It's cooling a bit. It's unbelievable. Okay. Those are good answers. But at the next barbecue next weekend, when they ask their other friend who's in real estate or their neighbors or the other neighbor's husband who's in real estate or someone at church who's in real estate, how's the market? It's great. It's unbelievable. It's hot. It's, you know, all of these things. Good. I want you guys to start thinking about the answer. Is that remarkable? Is someone going to go home and say, man, I had an amazing conversation with Eric today with a one-word answer? Okay. So, I mean, what if someone asks, how's the market? And your response is a little different. Your response is, oh my gosh, it's crazy right now. Last month I was working with some new clients. I'm not sure if you remember, if you know the Johnsons, they live over in Ridgewood Hills. But we've been looking for homes for months, and then we found their dream home, and it had just come on the market that afternoon. So we went over there, checked it out. I don't want to bore you with the details, but some crazy back and forth happened. We actually ended up winning the bidding war. They definitely paid a little more than they wanted, and we just closed last week. So honestly, it's pretty crazy. If you're a seller in this market, you've thought of selling, it could be the right time. The way you tell the story, the way you answer in a conversation is going to start to set yourself apart. Now, I have 1,000 people on this call right now. If 1,000 of you start to get better at the conversation, if you become remembered and remarkable in your answers, you're going to see a crazy thing start to happen. You're going to see your friends, I call it the sprinkler effects. Your friends might give you a referral once a year, and you're happy with that, but they might have 5. So they're gonna kind of sprinkle them out. They're gonna give referrals to one of their friends and another of their friends. You don't want that. You want every referral. You want your friends to think to themselves they're crazy if they refer somebody else. You start to answer like this, and we start to see a difference in the amount of referrals you're getting from your friends and family, because it feeds on each other. So we have to be remembered. We have to be remembered, okay? I love, guys, thanks for, I mean, I've probably just had 500 responses. Thanks, guys. Your communications, if they're remarkable, will have you remembered. And I'm gonna say this again, the answer to how's the market, the answer to how's business, the answer to how's life, can be the difference between whether they like you or trust you more in your professional world than the 10 other they know just like you or that do the job that you do. So I want to start with that. Now, once you realize that we have to be seen individually unique in our profession amongst the thousands of realtors in our marketplace, then we start to realize, you know, what we have to do. Now, I want to have a little lesson. We're gonna dig for those of you on the call who are sticking around. We still have 1,000 people on the call. We're gonna dive a little deeper now, and I still want you asking some questions. So, how do we set ourselves apart? How do we create that? So, what is your brand? When I'm in front of an audience and I say, "What is your brand?" Oftentimes I hear your company, your color scheme, your logos, how you present yourself, and that's not your brand. Your brand is the space you occupy in people's mind when they think of you. And for me, when I was a realtor, remember, I drove down the street thinking that every single real estate for sale sign that was in the yard, that those people were missing out on the best realtor in the marketplace. It pissed me off that everyone wasn't using me. I wanted to occupy the space in people's mind that when real estate popped up, I popped up. So it's this, your brand is the space you occupy in people's mind when they think about you. Is it, you know, fair, okay, mediocre, decent? Like, what are you putting out to the world? Are your conversations just okay? Guys, it's okay. We need to be honest with ourselves. What we're putting out in our marketing, what we're putting out in Facebook and social media, all of those things, is it just okay? And we actually are an industry of around 1.4 million people who sometimes settle for just good, all right? And that is something I would hope to change as we grow Breakthrough Broker. I wanna make sure everyone using our stuff wants to be a little better than good, because if you are just that much better than good, you're going to see a crazy increase in what you bring home to your family. And that's what we want to do. When somebody thinks of you, I want them thinking amazing. I want them thinking to themselves, oh my God, I can't wait to see Eric again. So, you know, There were things that we did, Nathan and I did, when we sold homes to make sure we were memorable. You know, this is a little side note. I want to promise you guys something. It's the way you make people feel. It's not logical, it's emotional. So Nathan, you know, Nathan and I used to, we used to put a 12 pack of beer, a pizza, and a roll of, and a, like a 4-pack of toilet paper for our buyers at the house at closing, so that when they were moving and went home, they had some stuff, you know, especially the toilet paper that would help them during the move. And, you know, when, if I can promise you that if 3 years down the road, I liked and commented on their Facebook page when they were in Maui on vacation, and I got them a home, 10% discount, we got 150 inspection items done, we got all kinds of crazy stuff for their buyer side, I can guarantee the husband and wife are on the beach, they see me like and comment on their post, and they'd say to themselves, oh honey, remember when we were moving, Eric left that pizza and toilet paper, that was so cool. So your brand is you and how you make them feel. It's good to be a good realtor, I get it, and be technical, but let's be thought of as remarkable and amazing and awesome. And that's a feeling you give them. It's not necessarily the deal you got them. I hope that makes sense with you guys. So this all starts with you. And I think we've talked about this. I'm going to keep saying it. You actually have to work at this. You actually have to be better than everyone else. It won't fall in your lap. You can't wish to be better than everyone else. You can't just be friendlier than the other 10 realtors because they're friendly too. So we actually have to be better. So everyone on this call, I'd like you to ask more of yourself. So what does that mean? It means go to more classes, and I'm not talking CE classes. I'm actually a fan of non-CE, and those like managing brokers on this call may freak out when I say this, and trainers on this call may freak out when I say this, but I like to tell people kind of take the least amount of continuing education as you can. It's good. You can do your ethics, you can do your contract changes, and then go to classes that help you grow your business. Learn how to be a business person. Learn how to do marketing. Learn how to do some Facebook stuff. Okay? Go to classes that help you be a better marketer of you. Okay? Read books outside of the real estate industry. Read books. You know, I drive my partners crazy. I drive Nathan crazy. I drive my wife crazy. I travel a lot. Some of you know I travel almost every week. I'm on the road with Breakthrough Broker. I listen to at least a book a week on Audible. It's like the best thing that ever happened. That's my favorite app on my phone. And it just keeps my mind moving forward. I like to learn things about the world that help me in little teeny ways. Know the stats. Now, little quick story. When I became a cop, right out of college, 22 years old, police officer, Fort Collins Police Department. I knew nothing about the world. So I was a cop for 13 years. They handled my 401k, my stocks, my insurance, everything. I did nothing but cop work, chase bad guys. Then I retired and got into real estate. I knew nothing about the real world. I knew nothing about the stock market, nothing. And I started doing some relocation for doctors. I fell into it. And I couldn't have an amazing, remarkable conversation. So I went out, I got a subscription to Investor's Business Daily, and I read it cover to cover every day for 18 months. I still have those papers. I don't know, I'm a hoarder. I kept them all. Don't ask me why. Probably because it's an expensive subscription. Cover to cover for 18 months, just trying to learn more about that world so I could have a very good conversation with investors and with people that knew more about that than me. So you have to work at it. You have to go out and do that. Know the stats. My board of realtors used to send me stats every week, and I'd delete them. Delete, 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 delete. I hated the stats, not a numbers guy. Then I heard a conversation with a realtor talking to someone else about the stats in my office. And I was like, whoa, that was an amazing conversation. That realtor looked great. That was a remarkable dialogue that he had. So I started looking at the stats, know the stats, know your unemployment rates and how they affect the region, know days on market, know the stats that are coming out and that are being given to you. And then technique mastery, find one or two things that you're amazing at and really latch on to that. So for me, I like to give examples. So for me, I was a school cop for a while, school resource officer, Fort Collins Police Department, Poudre School District. I loved it. It was probably one of the best gigs I did as a cop. And I got to know the school district really, really well. So I dug even deeper. And when I was a realtor, I had an unbelievable knowledge of the school district. So I was able to put someone in my car and say, hey, just to let you know, the school district has three separate curriculums. There's a core knowledge curriculum, a standard curriculum, and an experiential based learning curriculum. And these are how all three work, depending on what your kids' needs are and how they learn. And I can show you where those schools are in the district so you can make some decisions on where you might want to live. I even knew some principals that I was able to drive them to if I made a quick phone call and they could meet them. That was my tech, that was my mastery. That was what I was, what I chose to be really good at. You guys have that inside you. There's something like that inside you that you have to pull out and be able to really wow somebody with. Let's keep going. What value are you bringing to the conversation? What unique knowledge? How can you help? And listen, listen, listen. So this is interesting. How many coffee meetings are you guys going to a week? You guys should be going to coffee meetings. You should be meeting with people and talking about them, not you. All right. So a lot of what I train in some skill mastery, and Sean probably trains this too, who's on the call, is the ability to have a valuable dialogue. So it's not just the barbecue. It's everywhere you're communicating with people. There's a great book called The Encore Effect. And those of you that like to read should check this out. It's a very quick read. It's an older book called The Encore Effect. You could probably read it in an evening. I love it. It's about when you walk away from somebody that they want to see you again. It's remarkable conversations. Get this book. It's awesome. So if you go to coffee or lunch with somebody and they're a human resource director and they just happen to be in your sphere of influence, what are you going to talk about? You're going to talk about the weather and the kids? Because that's where our conversations typically go to. And when I have the same conversation with our title partners when they're trying to get your business, and I talk to them about, what are they talking to you about coffee? What are you talking to your realtors about coffee, the weather and the kids? Let's get away from that. Of course, you need to build some rapport, but let's get away from that a little bit and have a conversation that delivers value. Let's talk about their business. Ask people about them. Have them talk to you and listen, listen, listen. The more you listen, the more remarkable you're going to be to them because your answers can be tailored to their needs. So I have a question for you guys. I'm going to reopen I closed my question bar for a second. What do professionals do? We all want to be professionals. We say we're professionals. Realtors are professional board. What do real professionals do? Can somebody tell me? They educate, that's true. What else? They learn a lot, yep. They specialize in their field, thanks David. All great answers, but I think most real professionals, they just practice, practice, practice. Baseball players, these guys, these pro baseball players have been playing baseball since they could walk. And they still go to the stadium 4 hours early to take batting practice. Golfers take like 10,000 swings a month in practice. Craziness, right? But if I ask my agents to role play, they used to roll their eyes and then not show up at the meeting because they knew they'd have to role play. Guys, your answers, being remarkable and having a great conversation and being able to respond at a barbecue better than 10 other realtors takes practice. It takes some role play. You know, my wife is a new residential realtor. She's been in the institutional property management side for 7 years and decided she wants to sell houses. And I asked her when we were on a walk the other day, I said, why would I hire you? What makes you better than the neighbor across the street? Because neighbor across the street's in real estate. And she said, my experience. And then we had to talk about what more can she say? You know, so we pulled it out. She said, well, I worked with institutional investors who owned thousands of properties, helping them drive the most profit available while at the same time making sure that the tenants had an unbelievable place to live. Now we're getting somewhere. And I said, all right, say that into your phone, into your voice memo, and let's build on that. Then we looked at, she used to be in the hospitality industry. She was a Royal Service concierge. So she learned the value of customer service. So if you combine her value with customer service and her experience in the investment world and helping people drive the most profit, we've got a great story going there. But it has to be practiced over and over and over for it to roll out of your tongue like it's part of your DNA. So when you're at the barbecue and you can strut your stuff and you can say in your mind, everyone at this barbecue is crazy if they don't use me as the realtor. Why? Because A, B, C, and D. And you're living the part, right? So this is how to be the one realtor your friends choose when they know 10 others. We have to live it, right? We have to be part and think to ourselves that we're part of that. So it takes practice. So those of you on the call, don't shy away from role play. Find a partner. Go to your office and say, hey, I want to do some role play. Let's write out some scripts and dialogue. So one of the things, I'm on a tangent, but we're getting close to being done. We used to have floor duty at our office. Floor duty is kind of funny. I don't think it happens much anymore, but we had a nice downtown office. A lot of people walk around in downtown Fort Collins, and we had actual walk-ins. So floor duty was good. You know, it wasn't just sign calls. It was walk-ins. People who like wanted to move to Fort Collins because their kids were going to college there and they loved the area. And I'd watch my realtors look at the people walking in like a deer in the headlights. So Nathan and I were like, all right, that's it. We're doing role play. So we actually had a meeting and we had people, fake people, friends of ours, walk in and say, hey, we want to buy a home. Invited them in the meeting. We role play. And so it's, you guys have to practice in order for this to work. You have to practice. Let's talk some specifics. So some of you that know me well know I'm a super hockey fan. I'm a big Avalanche fan. Those of you guys, anyone on the call in Detroit, you can hang up now. Inside hockey joke. So the thing is that Wayne Gretzky, who's like the Michael Jordan of hockey, he said, sorry for sniffling, guys. I'm just clearing out a summer cold. Wayne Gretzky had a famous quote. He was asked, why are you so good? Like, why are you the best hockey player in history? And he said, you know what? It's because most hockey players go to the puck, where the puck is. And I go to where the puck is going to be. Well, I think the crazy stat is that most adult Americans are on Facebook, like 82% of adult Americans are on Facebook. And some crazy stat, like 77% of adult Americans are on Facebook more than once a day. So we should maybe be on Facebook. And we can start to be seen as that go-to, sorry guys, we could be seen as that go-to realtor, and we can start to mold our sphere of influence to look at us as the guy or girl that they absolutely have to refer every time the word home comes up. So we can use social media in a couple different ways. But guys, this isn't a social media class. So those gurus on the call, that's fine. I'm not gonna get into anything crazy. These are just some ideas to leverage everyday social media, okay guys? So you can post expert content on your personal Facebook page. Like, what is expert content? Post days on market. Post a commentary on a news article that came out, how it can affect the price of their home. Real estate related content. Find articles and post them on your personal page. Add value to your sphere of influence on your personal Instagram and Facebook as it relates to your professional life. That's where you'll mold that brand. That's where you'll mold the space you occupy in their mind when you're posting interesting things about your work. All right, guys, and we'll dig in a little deeper here. So some of you know, it was a quick little tech lesson. Some of you know, and when you post on Facebook, like nobody really sees it, right? So we have to get a little more strategic. Facebook has this thing called an algorithm, and if you post something and someone likes it within a few seconds, they show more people. And then if someone does the like emoji, then they show more people. And that's kind of how it works. And I'm sure you guys have been like, man, I can't believe Heather's not on Facebook. She was like the most popular girl in college. And then you go find Heather. She lives in Atlanta and she's on Facebook every day. And then now since you've searched her and found her, you start seeing her in your newsfeed. So you guys have been, you're experiencing the Facebook algorithm. So I want to show you a little trick. You go to your Facebook homepage. This is your homepage or your newsfeed. On the left side of your newsfeed is a thing called friends lists. Friends lists. Okay. Now you're going to click on friends lists and it's going to say create a list. And you can start creating some lists. Now Facebook's letting you tell them who you'd like to see when you click on that list. So you can do past clients. You can do soccer friends, past coworkers. You can make a couple different lists here. And what's great about past clients and neighbor list, whatever lists you want to do, when you click on that list, you're now in it and you're seeing what they're doing. So if you do a past clients list, you're telling Facebook, I want to see what these people are doing. You can scroll through. And now what should you do in here? You should be in a great Facebooker. Like and comment with sincerity. Like and comment with sincerity. And then here, when you post here, this list is the only, will only see that post. So do more expert content in here. So you can leverage Facebook with your past clients to keep in front of them, because some disgusting percentage, like 12% of home buyers and sellers actually use the realtor that they used last time. That's terrible, that's our fault. It's not their fault. So post more expert content. You won't get banned from Facebook for posting a post like, here's a beautiful view from the backyard of my showing tonight, amazing house. That's okay. You can do that on your personal page. Okay. I want you to check in. So post commentary on local stats. Go find a fun video of a $49 million listing in Beverly Hills. Post it on your Facebook page and say, hey, this is pretty amazing. Everybody check this out. Love to sell that thing. You know, post a video of one of your open houses. Post a time lapse of you putting out like 30 open house signs. Get a little ingenuitive and check in. That's the easiest thing. If you guys are going to your office meeting and you're meeting with a client, you know, check in at, you know, at Houston's, and in the commentary, meeting with the second investor of the day. Those things are good for your sphere of influence to see what you're doing and drumming into their head and that space in their mind that you are their go-to realtor. So there are things we can do without being cheesy, without spending money on our personal page, okay, on that personal page to be able to do that. Guys, there's a Facebook lists tutorial on Breakthrough Broker. If I flew by that too fast, you can go to breakthroughbroker.com. In the search bar, type in Facebook lists, and you'll find it in our Facebook content. And it'll walk you through step by step on what I just showed you. So let's keep going. I don't like to go too much longer than we're already going. I want to answer some questions. Those of you that are doing a newsletter, either email or direct mail, start to actually look at what you're sending. You know, if you're sending things like move your clocks forward, it's daylight savings time. And, you know, trim your shrubs three times a year for curb appeal. Like, that stuff isn't all that engaging. Maybe switch your newsletters to have some expert content, something of value to your sphere, and like really look at what you're sending out. Would you read it? Is it something that interests you? Because like I'll tell you right now, I haven't read a newsletter from my car insurance guy for like ever, and they keep sending it to me. So I'm not I think if it was something other than insurance related, because insurance is not exciting to me, I might read it. So make sure that you're sending stuff that's interesting that you would read, okay? That you would read. The name of the book, Rochelle, is Encore Effect. The Encore Effect by Mark Sanborn. You can find it on Amazon. So a lot of us are just hung up on me. We went from 1,000 people when, and then I just did blog, podcasts, and Facebook Live, and we went to like 200. No, I'm kidding. We still have 1,000. Here's the thing, guys. A lot of people, like if I'm in front of you and I'm like, is anyone doing Facebook Live? Like two people answer. Is anyone doing BombBomb Facebook or BombBomb video emails? Three people might raise their hand. And a blog, like, oh my gosh, what would I write about? I don't have time to do a blog. Well, this is how you can become an expert. It's not terribly complicated. And those of you that don't like video because you don't like the way you look and sound, I have crazy news for you. That's how you look and sound. Okay? So why don't you look into this? Because if you have a website or you can write a little article, you know, one of the things people say is, what do I write about? What can I talk about on a Facebook Live? This bottom, the bottom bullet point, if it's interesting to you, talk about it. If you're, you know, if you had a bad Monday morning commute and you wanted to quick do a Facebook Live and say, hey, I have a quick question for everybody. What car, make and model, do you think are the worst drivers on the road? I don't want to offend anybody, but I can tell you what I think. I just had a terrible experience. It took me an hour and a half to get to work, whatever. I don't care. If you translate that into a little more expert content about real estate, days on market, how it can affect home price. Is it a buyer's market, a seller's market? Take the stats that your realtor board or MLS gives you and write a commentary on it. It's very easy to do those things. Once you start doing that and putting it on your Facebook, putting it on your Instagram, putting it on your website, sending it out in your email newsletters, over time, we're working on that space in your sphere of influence mind that you occupy, that you are the go-to person when anyone in the world mentions real estate. Anyone in the world. You know, I am so evangelical about some of my partners in this industry that if I hear someone talking at Starbucks about needing a landscaper, I won't even know them, and I'll tap them on the shoulder and be like, you need to call Long's Peak Landscape. You know, so you just have to be that person in their life. Also, think outside the box. If you want to be the one realtor that your friends choose when they know 10 others, do what the 10 others aren't doing. I'll say that again. Do what the 10 others aren't doing. Do something interesting. Create a webinar. You can get a free Zoom account. Do a webinar on what goes into calculating a home value and invite everyone in your sphere. Put it on Facebook. Create a little email. Push it out to your email addresses. And do a quick webinar on what goes into calculating home value. I think that's, you know, that's little things like that go so far with the people you know. And I can't even explain to you what that would be. You know, this is something that I think we've gotten away from, and it might look funny to you, but like we go to a lot of parties and happy hours with other realtors and mortgage and title and stuff like that. Why don't you have parties and happy hours with your sphere of influence? Have a client appreciation party twice a year. Schedule a happy hour at a bar and invite all the people you know. Just say, I wanted to do a fall happy hour. The kids are back in school. I just wanted to connect with everybody. So the more face-to-face, the more how's life with a remarkable answer about how great real estate is, the more you're going to start drilling that in to them, all right? And pop buys aren't dead. Someone asked me what the heck is a pop buy a couple weeks ago. Like, go see people face to face. This job should be 40, 50 hours a week. And so stop by, meet people, go to the house. Hey, I just wanted to pop in and say, hey, I wanted to give you this. It's my new newsletter. I don't know, whatever you want to bring. I had a friend who did like 4th of July little flag packets, and he walked around and he just knocked on doors of all the people he knew and did these pop buys. They're not dead. And last is social proof. So if you have people writing nice things about you, share it with your sphere of influence. Every transaction, you should get a testimonial. Whether you send them the Yelp link and say, can you Yelp me out? Whether you send them the Zillow link to write a review about you, that's great. But when they write it, I mean, imagine this is kind of cool. I found this years ago, but I use it because I love it. You know, this fellow bought my first condo and David worked together. We worked together for 6 months because it was hard to find a good fit for me. Even with my very busy work schedule, David was committed to helping me find the perfect place. While dealing with a difficult seller, he advocated for me, making sure that I was supported getting the best deal possible. I would recommend David very highly. You take a screenshot of this, you post it on your Facebook and Instagram, and you at all your, you know, David, you at David and his wife and their friends and say, thank you so much for the kind words. Promote what people are saying about you. It's okay. Thank you so much for the kind words. This is why I'm in the business. Okay. All of those things are super helpful. All of those things promoted back to your sphere of influence start to create that space in their mind where you are better than the ones they know. So this isn't rocket science, guys. You know, I think hopefully some of you weren't hoping to come on the call and find like these crazy silver bullets. It's amazingly hard work. But when you focus on it and you tell yourself, I'm going to be the best realtor in my market, people are freaking crazy if they use anybody else, and you start to live that persona and you have great conversations that you've practiced, this starts to happen over time. And you'll see a drastic increase in your business. And you know us at Break the Broker, all we want for you guys is to make sure you will sell some more homes. So I want to make sure I have someone here. This is really interesting. I have someone here saying, come on, man, every agent is already doing this. And unfortunately, Edwin, I would say every agent isn't doing this. I'm fortunate enough to be in front of 400,000 agents using Breakthrough Broker and over 12,000 agents face-to-face last year. And this isn't common sense to realtors. So this is something that maybe you're doing, and I hope you're doing. If you are doing, you're probably the one realtor your friends choose. But that's why we had 3,000 people sign up for this call. So I'm happy that people took this call. We're ready to we are ready to focus on being better ourselves so that everyone in our sphere loves us. And guys, have a great month. We have some very great speakers coming up. We have Chelsea Pites coming up this month. Some of you know Chelsea. She's a national author and one of the best Instagram marketers in America. She'll be talking to us later in August about creating more followers on Instagram and leveraging it for your real estate business. In September, we're going to have Travis Tom back at Elevated Marketing. He's one of the, if not the, number one Facebook marketing experts in America. He'll be on talking some new Facebook rules and strategies for us to leverage in the fall of 2019 leading up to the new year. And then in October, we're going to have Sean Carpenter on the call. He's a renowned speaker throughout the country, and he's going to be talking about getting back in the game. And so another skill base, we're going to do two technology webinars in the next 2 months and another skills based webinar in October. So we hope you guys found something helpful about this and can't wait to, thanks Will, can't wait to see you guys on these calls. Everybody have a fantastic month. Stay safe out there, and we'll talk to you soon.